We've known for many decades now that all cancers are due to abnormalities in DNA. Now, although we've known that, it's remarkable how rudimentary our knowledge is about what the processes that cause these abnormalities, these mutations in our DNA, are. Now, we know about some. For example, we know that if we smoke cigarettes, that tobacco smoke contains chemicals that damage DNA in our lungs, and that damaged DNA turns into mutations, and those mutations in our lung cause lung cancer. However, for most other cancers, we do not know what the underlying mutational processes are that have been operative over the lifetime of the patient to generate the cancer. So what we have done in this study is to sequence the complete genomes of 21 breast cancers. And from those 21 breast cancers, we have made catalogues of the mutations that are present. And we've looked into those catalogues to see if we can find particular patterns that reflect imprints that those mutational processes have made on the DNA sometime in the past.
In our research, we were intending to study the entire genomic sequence, the entire DNA sequence of cancer genomes from breast cancers. In the past, cancer research has often focused on identifying individual cancer genes, individual genes that are driving cancer, because these become obvious targets for cancer treatment. But the human genome is vast. There's 3,000 million building blocks, or 3,000 million bases in the human genome. And cancers are the ultimate genetic pathology. We have many, many thousands of mutations in cancers. So we reasoned that if we use the entire complement of genetic changes in a cancer, that we would understand more about the biology of cancer development. What's changed in science in the last 5 to 10 years has been the improvement in DNA sequencing technology. Where previously we could only sequence small chunks of the genome, now we can sequence the entire genome in a very short time.
The most dramatic finding from this study is that across the 21 breast cancers, there were a number of different processes acting to cause the mutations. Kind of imagined going into it that actually each breast cancer would look pretty similar to every other breast cancer. But in fact, there are at least 7 or 8 different processes that are causing mutations, and they operate to different degrees in different people. And trying to tease apart and understand what these processes are may give us insights into how breast cancers develop in some women, but not in other women.
We found in the first instance 5 major processes that can cause one letter of code to be changed to another letter of code. And of these, there is one of those 5 processes for which at the moment we really do not know what the underlying biological mechanism is, and we had never really seen it before. But this seems to overwhelm about 10% of breast cancers with mutations. So that's one of the interesting things we found. The second thing we have found that's of interest is that there are, in some cancers, small parts of the genome which appear to have been a target of huge numbers of mutations. And we call this process Ctegis, which is Greek for thunderstorm, because of the accumulation of these enormous numbers of mutations in these parts of the genome. And what is remarkable is that in each of these cancers, the particular part of the genome which is mutated is different. So at the moment, we really do not understand how the mutational process is directing itself to these different parts of the genome in different cancers.
We can also tell the timing of these processes. We can tell which ones have come on early, which ones have come on later. So we can see additional structure in the development of cancers, and that it's far more complex than we ever thought. We think from our analysis that some of those mutations are probably happening in our cells normally, and they are probably happening before the cell becomes a cancer. And then some of those processes die off as the cancer becomes more aggressive. There are other processes that come on later during cancer development, and they may contribute to the aggressiveness of the cancer. So there are different mutational processes They come on at different times during cancer development and during normal cellular development as well.
At this time, we really don't understand what the majority of these processes are that are causing mutations. We know for maybe two or three of the processes the kind of what's going on at the DNA level to cause them. But for most of them, we don't know. What we can say on the basis of this study is that most of them are specific to the cancer. They're not the same mutational processes that are going on in the rest of our body.
For some of those mutational processes that we identified, cells were probably accumulating mutations even before they turned into cancers. But at some point, just as the cancer is developing, it can diverge into smaller families, smaller populations, or clones of cells. At some point, one of those clones becomes the dominant clone. It expands to become the dominant clone, and that is likely to trigger diagnosis.
One of the striking findings of the research is that every patient that we looked at had evidence for a dominant subclonal lineage, by which I mean a subclonal lineage that contributed more than 50% of the tumor cells. Now, there's no way a priori reason why a breast cancer should indeed have such a dominant subclonal lineage. And yet there must be an explanation for it to be so universal in these cases that we studied. So what we think is that it's actually the expansion of this dominant subclone that triggers diagnosis. If you imagine the average breast cancer being 10 centimeters cubed when it's diagnosed, then a dominant subclone like this will contribute maybe 50-60% of the mass of that tumor and may well be the difference between a tumor being detectable by, say, palpation or mammography, or it not being detectable.
So these are early studies. They've already yielded a number of new mutational processes which we never encountered before, and which we are now going to have to investigate what they're due to. But as the sequencing of cancer genomes accelerates, as thousands and tens of thousands of cancer genomes are sequenced, there's no doubt that we're going to find more mutational processes that have been operative. And that'll give us a much more complete idea of what has been causing the mutations in our cancers. In other words, what's been causing our cancers in the first place.